Hi, Professor Granlund here. In this chapter, we'll be investigating the lipids. We'll look at the chemical structure and functions. Lipids tend to come in three groups, the triglycerides, the phospholipids, and the sterols. What they have in common is that they're primarily composed of carbon and hydrogen, and they have a common chemical property. A significant portion of the molecule is nonpolar, which makes them hydrophobic. In addition to the structure and function, we're going to take a look at the digestion and absorption, the transport in the blood, and the AMDR. To get you started, I'm going to point out a few topics that we see frequently in news stories lately. Topics like omega-3s and 6s, trans fatty acids, coconut oil, and blood cholesterol levels. When you look at the chemical structure of triglycerides and phospholipids, you'll see long chains of carbon and hydrogen called fatty acids. Fatty acids can either be saturated or unsaturated. But what the heck does that mean? It refers to the carbon atoms being saturated with hydrogen or not. Unsaturated fatty acids have one or more double bonds between carbons where they could hold more hydrogen. While this may seem insignificant, it makes a huge difference to the properties of those molecules and their health effects. The current recommendation is to have less than 10% of your calories coming from saturated fats, and that's because higher levels are related to increased risk of cardiovascular disease. I'm going to point out three things related to these fatty acids. One of them is that while saturated fats are generally made by animals, they are also produced by tropical plants, including coconuts. So why is coconut oil now considered to be good to eat? The reason is that coconut oil is made of short and medium chain saturated fats, whereas the animals make longer chain fats, saturated fats. These fats are handled differently by the body. Rather than being absorbed into the lymph and ending up in fat cells, they're more likely to be absorbed into the blood and be used by cells for energy production. A second related topic is those omega-3s and omega-6s. These are essential fatty acids. We can't make them, but we need them for a variety of functions in the body, including the inflammation response. Acute inflammation is an important part of the immune system. Chronic inflammation, of course, is related to many disorders. Omega-6s tend to promote inflammation, and omega-3s act as anti-inflammatories. You need a balance of both of them. They're both very abundant in a variety of foods, but in the American diet, we tend to eat a lot more omega-6s. Many nutritionists are going to encourage people to increase their intake of omega-3s. Omega-3s are found in fish, especially salmon, anchovies, halibut, sardines, some nuts, especially walnuts, some shellfish, especially mussels and oysters and crab, and flax seeds. Omega-6s are found in soybeans and corn and safflower oil and sunflower oil and lots of different nuts and seeds. A third related topic is trans fats. Trans fats have been linked to increased risk of cardiovascular disease, and the recommendation is to try to avoid them. But where do they come from? While polyunsaturated fats are liquid at room temperature and have a relatively short shelf life in products, so to change those properties, we've created a process called hydrogenation. Voila, your corn oil is now corn oil margarine. If you read labels, you're going to be amazed at the number of products that say partially hydrogenated In nature, plants make polyunsaturated fatty acids only in a cis configuration, not in the trans configuration. That hydrogenation process sometimes ends up with those trans fats, however. Luckily, we have an additional process we can do now that converts those trans And so you see a lot of products that say contains no trans fatty acids. If you're following the recommendations, these products would be the better choice. In this chapter, you'll also look at the structure and function of the phospholipids and the sterols. You will go into further depth of the digestive process and absorption. Because lipids are hydrophobic, meaning they're not soluble in water, and because we are primarily made of water, they do take some special processing, such as emulsifying them with bile to make micelles in the GI tract. And once they've been absorbed into those intestinal cells, they process them into chylomicrons. I'm sure some of you have heard of good cholesterol and bad cholesterol, and maybe even had your cholesterol levels checked. Let's take a closer look at this. Chylomicrons are made by those intestinal cells, and as they circulate through the body, cells use lipoprotein lipase to take the fatty acids out and store it in the cell. The liver recycles chylomicrons into a new package for transport called VLDLs, very low density lipoproteins. These are mostly composed of triglycerides, hence the low density. Just like the chylomicrons, cells will use that lipopolylipase to remove those fatty acids. What's left over has a higher ratio of protein to fat, and so they're now called LDLs, low-density lipoproteins. These packages have higher levels of cholesterol, which cells also need. However, sometimes these cholesterol-laden packages can degrade in the blood, and the cholesterol can then stick to the vessel walls. High levels of LDL may increase your risk of vascular disease, so LDLs are referred to as bad cholesterol. The liver also makes cholesterol vacuums. They're called HDLs, high-density lipoproteins. These suck up the cholesterol from the blood and return it to the liver for reprocessing. Hence, HDLs are called good cholesterol. Cholesterol is not actually an essential nutrient. We need it, but we can make sufficient quantities of it ourselves. People with heart disease or a family history of high cholesterol are usually advised to limit their intake of high cholesterol foods such as eggs, cheese, and shellfish. All right, I'm going to let you work through the chapter now. Let me know when you have questions.